Let's look at this idea of areas in a little bit more detail. So the situation where we have area below the axis. So here's my function. If I want to find the area from A to B, that's above the axis, not a problem. We know we just integrate and that'll give me a positive number and that'll be the area, not a problem. But if I want to go from B to C, now because that is below the axis, the integral is going to be a negative number. So therefore the area, well, there's a couple of ways I could do it. You'll notice I've just said, oh, well, it'll be the negative of it. The negative out the front. Oh, and the other things, you could put absolute value signs around it. You could do things like that. But so if you want to find an area below the x-axis, so it'll be the negative of the integral because you want to end up with a positive amount, or the absolute value of the integral, that'll give you a positive amount, or instead of integrating from B to C, integrate from C to B, because then that will change it to a positive amount as well. It's a very beautifully drawn cubic, I'm sure you agree. Now, we're going to integrate from 1 to 1 to find this area, but if we did that, we're going to have a problem. Because of the symmetry, the bit below would be negative, the bit above would be positive, it'll cancel out and give us 0. And clearly, the area is not 0. So how we do it? Well, the bit below I can make negative. So I actually split it up into two areas and I can go from minus 1 to 0 but make that negative. So that'll be minus 1/4. The integration, of course, is still the same. But add 1 to the power over the power. Sub in and voila, we end up with a half unit square. Of course, the other way we could use this is recognize it's an odd function and just not worry about the bit below. And say, well, hang on, the area above must be the same as the area below. So I could do twice from 0 to 1 and work that one out. Once again, we get a half unit squared, which is fine if we have that symmetry. Obviously, if we don't have symmetry, we can't do that. Something like this, for instance. There's a bit above and a bit below. I can't go, oh, well, that's just going to be twice from minus 1 to 0. It might turn out that it is, by the way, but I don't know for sure. I mean, I can't tell whether that really is symmetric around negative 1 or not. So, all right, we'll split it up into two areas, the bit above and then minus the bit below. I prefer to swap the values. So you'll notice there, I've made it a plus, but I've swapped the values. The reason for doing that is you always substitute the top number in, minus substitute in the bottom. But notice now the two top numbers are the same. So I don't have to substitute it in twice. I'll just go two times what I get when I substitute in minus 1. And then minus the ones on the bottom. So minus when I substitute in negative 2 and minus when I substitute in naught. And it's a half unit squared. All right, well, what happens if instead of going to the x-axis, we want to find the area to the y-axis? We're going to have to put it so that x is the subject because we need the function in terms of y rather than function of x. Now, how do we know that? Well, it's quite easy because we're going to the y-axis, we have to do everything with respect to y because we're going to the y-axis, you see, as opposed to when we were going to the x-axis and everything was in terms of, yes, okay. So there you go. My area function becomes the y because we're going to the y-axis, hey? Clever that, huh? Now, the other thing, of course, we have to do is change the limits because they need to be in terms of y as well. So they need to be the y values. And then we just integrate as normal. So an example. Here's our, well, it looks like a parabola, but it's not. It's x to the power of 4. And we're going to the y-axis. So if I rearrange that, x is y to the power of 1/4. But I don't substitute 1 and 2 in. It would end up being 1 and 16. I want the y values that I'm going to sub in. But other than that, exactly the same. Add 1 to the power, over the power. Sub in the 16. Sub in the 1. You'll notice I didn't change that one into third form. And that's because I knew that the 4th root of 16 is an exact amount and the 4th root of 1 was an exact amount, so I didn't need to worry about changing that one. Well, what happens when we trap an area between two different curves? So there's one curve, function x. There's another curve, g of x. we want to find the area that's trapped in between these two curves. Well, obviously we'll need to find the point of intersection. That'll come in handy. And all we really need to do then is say, well, hang on, I know how to find the area under the red one. I know how to find the area under the blue one. I'll just subtract and I've got the area between the two curves. Simple enough idea. So it'll become the area under one, so a to b function x minus a to b g of x. But of course, remember our rules of integration, I can combine that into one integral. There might be things that end up cancelling, who knows? Then we get function x minus g of x dx. So we're going to find one enclosed between y equals x to the power of 5, y equals x, but the section in the positive quadrant. That's the first quadrant, in case you're wondering, where all the numbers are positive. So there's y equals x. There's y equals x to the power of 5, very flat at the base, steep at the side. I might have exaggerated, but I only want that bit in there. So a diagram's good, because you need to know which one's on top. So this one I'll be going x minus x to the power of 5. If I didn't draw the diagram and got it the wrong way around, and have x to the power of 5 minus x, what's going to happen? Yeah, I'll get a negative answer. So diagrams, and I know how you love drawing your diagrams, you know. Just did a rough little sketch, bang, okay, I know which one's on top. I'll need to find the point of intersection, and if it's not obvious, well, let's solve it simultaneously. When does x to the power of 5 equal x? I wonder. Hang on, I'll move that over, I'll factorize. Gives me possible solutions of 0 and plus or minus 1. Oh, which one do we want? I think it might be the plus 1. So, all right, we know our integral is going to go from 0 to 1. We're subtracting the pentic, it would be, wouldn't it, x to the power of 5? The pentic from the linear function. And then we add 1 to the power over the power. Sub in, and there's our answer, 1/3. Now, oh, actually, before I do that, the interesting thing about between two curves is you don't have to worry about when it's below the axis and above the axis. Or even if there's a bit above and a bit below, you still just subtract the top from the bottom. All right, let's have a look at the HSC one. And this one is all below. So we have a parabola and a straight line. This is a tuner paper. They do tend to over-explain the questions for you. The graph's there, okay, that's good. And by the way, in case you can't tell from the picture, they intersect at the points 4, 0, and A. Find the coordinates of A for 2 marks. So they're fair enough. How do we find the point of intersection? Solve them simultaneously. That's what we'll do. So x minus 4 equals x squared minus 4x. There's our quadratic. Now, of course, I already know one solution to this. Makes the factorizing easy. One of the solutions has to be 4, because we know it meets a 4. So x minus 4, x minus 1. A. Now, they did ask for the coordinates. I've only got the x value. So now comes the tricky bit, working out the y value. So 1 minus 3. Okay. Probably the y value is not that important. The x value is what we're really going to need to, I assume, eventually find the area of this. Oh, yes, what do you know? Now let's find the area of the shaded region. Okay. So it'll be the line minus the parabola. And we're going from 1 to 4. So let's tidy that up. We get minus x squared plus 5x minus 4. Add 1 to the power over the power. And eventually, 9 on 2, that one turns out to be. 9 on 2. Now have a look at this one from 2005. A circle and a parabola, but notice it's also trapped by the x-axis as well. So we can't simply go the top one minus the bottom one on this one. But they give us a clue. By considering the difference of two areas, find the area of the shaded region. Okay, that means I've got to break it up into two areas. They gave me the hint. So the reason why is because the boundaries change. If you work from left to right, because remember you're going to go top minus the bottom, if that changes, then you need a new integral. So if you look at it, starting from the left, circle minus parabola, circle minus parabola, circle minus parabola. We get to the point 1, circle minus parabola. Then it's, circle minus x-axis. So it's now a different integral. So we need to split it up there by considering two areas. So, all right, there's the area between the circle and the parabola, and there's the area between the circle and the x-axis. Okay. However, I'm going to use two different areas, because how about actually look at the shape? I don't need to integrate to find the area of a circle. We've got a lovely formula that does that for us. So I'm still considering two areas. I'm going to say it's the area of that quadrant minus the bit under the parabola from 0 to 1. And that'll give me the answer as well. And I think that's going to be a little bit easier. So quarter of a circle, quarter of pi r squared, minus, and I'm just integrating the parabola. I then don't have to rearrange the equation of the circle to find this new function. And we get a rather easy one to integrate. Add 1 to the power over the power. And there's our final answer, pi minus 5/6 of unit squared. I guess the trick to that question, or what you need to remember, is if it's a regular shape that you already have a formula for, don't waste time integrating. Use the formula that you already know. When that's the point of the formula at the same time. Ooh. So 11E, 11F, we're going to play with areas.